Good morning. Welcome everybody to Countryside Presbyterian Church, our 10:30 service, and thank you, those of you joining us from home, for worshiping with us today. For those of us here for the first time, visitors, please, if you would, take one of the visitor tags from the pew pocket in front of you, and write your name on it, and place it on your top, and that way we'll be able to greet you by name with good Christian fellowship. And also, everybody, please remember, you know the drill, sign the attendance pads, pass them up and down the row, so we can make sure that everybody knows who they're worshiping with, brothers and sisters. Well, you've seen the announcements in our insert. We have an additional announcement from Pastor Rhonda.
School starts on the 12th of August. We, as a session, decided to extend our collection of school supplies one more Sunday. So that includes next Sunday. The reason being, the session also decided that to give some of those school supplies to the two elementary schools in Marion Oaks, as well as the middle school. There are a lot of families. I have checked this out with the school board. They have a lot of families over in Marion Oaks in need, and they have no transportation to get down to Interfaith to get supplies. So as a church, we are doing the ministry of Jesus Christ by providing school supplies for those children in elementary and middle school. So it's extended another week, and Walmart has the best prices on school supplies. I've checked out everything. So at this time, may we share the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you. Please stand and share the peace of Christ with those around you.
Let us now turn our hearts and minds to worship. opening hymn today is number 65, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Please rise. Please join me now in our call to worship. Let us remember all your sheep, O Lord, those of the fold and those not of the fold, lest we forget that you are the one good shepherd of all. When they worship you by other names, let us remember that you have left yourself without witnesses in any place, lest we forget that you are the good shepherd. When they define goodness by other standards, let us remember that you turned a lecherous monarch into a righteous king. Lest we forget that you are the good shepherd. When they perpetrate deeds of utter selfishness, let us remember that you judge the thoughts of our hearts as well as the deeds of their hands. Lest we forget that you are the good shepherd of all. When they express mindless prejudice, let us remember the log in our eyes before condemning the speck in theirs. Lest we forget that you are the good shepherd of all. When they commit crimes of wanton violence, let us remember that you alone can separate the goats from the sheep, lest we forget that you are the good shepherd of all. Grant us, O Lord, by whatever name we call you, so to love in your love that we may be united in your service. Let's join together in prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, you know that we are sinners, and you treat us as if we were not. You know that we are unworthy of your love, and you treat us as if we were. We thank you for welcoming us into your presence. We bow before you in confidence, not because of your goodness, but because of your grace. We pray that you will repeat in us the miracle that you have worked on others, converting worshipers into witnesses and believers into disciples. Amen. Please be seated. Our first scripture lesson today is from the 14th Psalm. Fools say in their hearts, there is no God. They are corrupt. They do abominable deeds. There is no one who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven on humankind to see if there are any who are wise, who seek after God. They have all gone astray. They are all alike perverse. There is no one who does good. No, not one. Have they no knowledge, all the evildoers, who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon the Lord? There they shall be in great terror, for God is with the company of the righteous. You would confound the plans of the poor, but the Lord is their refuge. Oh, that deliverance for Israel would come from Zion, when the Lord restores the fortunes of his people. Jacob will rejoice, and Israel will be glad.
This world of fear and doubt, on my knees I ask the question, why a lonely heavy cross I must bear. Then he tells me in my prayers, it's because I am trustworthy. He gives me strength. Oh,
Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of John, the sixth chapter. After this, Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was coming near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming towards him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, got into a boat, and started across the lake to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The lake had become rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the lake and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat. And immediately the boat reached the land towards which they were going. This is the word of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I grew up in a small house. 2 bedrooms, well, let me put it this way, were small. My parents' double-sized bed barely fit into a bedroom. My father was a government employee, whatever you want to say, and he was paid every 2 weeks. A $20 bill was put in the change purse in the drawer underneath the telephone. My mother would go to the grocery store every 2 weeks. She would ride back with my father when he came home for lunch, and she would buy the groceries for 2 weeks. You know how many years ago that has been? If $20 would buy 2 weeks of groceries, think back how many years. Prices, I remember, were much cheaper then. A can of cream of chicken soup, I think, was buy one for three cents and buy two for five cents. She went to the local Kroger's, which had the cheapest food around. We didn't have any desserts. We didn't have any cookies or cake or pies. Our refrigerator was one of those that you had the small little freezer in the middle. Anybody remember those? You couldn't fit very much in. An ice cube tray, maybe, and a little bit of meat. Grandma Link always invited us over to her house on Sunday at noon. She had fried chicken, mashed potatoes, and gravy. And to this day, I can't remember what the vegetable was. Jell-O salad and ice cream came in the gallon containers from Kroger's. And she always bought chocolate, and she said, the reason why I buy chocolate is because my granddaughter, Rhonda, loves chocolate. She didn't do anything for my sister. She did it for me. Don't ask me why. I do not know. But that was our dessert for the week. I always knew that the time was approaching payday for the 2 days before payday, we would have scrambled eggs and toast for our dinner meal. The eggs had come from my grandmother's, where she had paid 10 cents a dozen for them. Prices really have changed. Where there was a farmer in her congregation that she could buy eggs from, and we always got eggs. But those scrambled eggs and toast, like I said, that's what we had for dinner two nights in a row. My grandparents would come and visit in the spring and once in the fall, and we got an assortment of cakes, pies, cookies. And we knew Grandma was coming. She also cleaned our bedroom, too. She threw out stuff. What are you keeping this for? And out it would go. My mother didn't do any of that. She always brought plenty of canned pickles, green beans, cucumbers, brought plenty of tomatoes, you name it. It was on our shelf in the basement. Grandma always made sure that we had fresh chicken. She would bring chicken and then dress them on our back porch. That was always interesting to me, how you dress a chicken. I don't think I could do that today. Grandma did all the cooking, and she would turn around and say, Virginia, don't you know how to do this? That was my mother. I know how to do all those things just because I think of my grandmother. She would make sure that we were well fed. There's plenty of food in our refrigerator so that we had plenty to eat. You know, as I went over the scripture for today, read it several times, there were plenty of people that had gathered there, the 5,000. I'm sure that they did not have enough to eat in their homes. We look up families today, and as I called the school board, I was told how many families are in dire need today in Marion County. Dire need for clothes for their children to start a new school year, for school supplies, you name it. They are in need. We don't see that so much. We have it nice and easy. We have enough. But also within any congregation, any gathering of people, we also see a need. a care and concern. We see that today. If we would go and look at some of the places people live, some of the trailers that they live in, some of the places they call home. Jesus' mission and purpose was to preach to the people, to take care of them, and to guide them along the path of life. Whether it was by food that they take by mouth, or whether it was by food that they listen to Christ preaching, both spiritually and physically. At the beginning of the gospel story, the scene is crucial. Jesus' compassion for the hungry, for the shepherdless crowds, the disciples ask, and Jesus tells them what is to be done. And Jesus puts the question to Philip of how the crowds are going to be fed in order to test him. And Philip responds with a response, 6 months' wages won't pay for the food needed to feed this crowd. The disciples wanted to send the people away to get their own food. But Jesus wants to give them something. Something. Because the village would not provide what Jesus needed. All we have to do is go back to the Old Testament and we think about the Israelites in the wilderness. They saw what they had been given to eat upon, the berries, the leaves. That's how they maintained themselves. And they kept looking for signs of God's power and strength. But if we go back to Philip, Jesus does not rebuke Philip and Andrew, but he takes charge of the situation. He gives instructions to the disciples. Distribute the loaves and the fish that this little boy had given them, and we will have plenty to eat, for God has power. We look at fish, it's a sign of the early church. The disciples were fishermen, and fish with bread would have been a common meal. My husband decided to take me out to eat last night. We usually go out to eat on Saturday evening. And he said, what do you want to eat? I'd been busy all day with soccer, and I said, I want a nice salad. And I went fish. So he goes through all the whole list. And I said, well, you get to pick one. And on the way there, I knew where we were going. And sure enough, I had fish, and I had a wonderful salad at Cheddar's. And I saw members of the church walking out the door, and I couldn't get to them. But if we look at Christ today, he feeds the 5,000, probably more than 5,000. They thought it was 5,000, but we really don't know. He invited them to sit and to listen. He invites men and women and children. He included everyone, and he feeds them by saying the word. He feeds them, and there were leftovers. 12 baskets full of leftovers. That's a lot of leftovers after feeding everyone, which also means there was leftover from Jesus and preaching the word and doing miracles.
crowd. A crowd was fed. A crowd that had gone to listen and to hear the word. Two fish, bread. A wonder that happened. And the disciples were told together all those leftovers. We're not told really how the crowd reacted, but they listened to a prophet that guided them in ministry. They listened to a prophet that had words to say about the power of God. They listened to a prophet with the hands of care and love. And in the end of the passage, the disciples go out on a boat to listen and to be guided. And Jesus appears to them. Jesus appears, and he wants to be part of their lives. Jesus wants each one of us to look at his appearance in our lives as disciples, as we listen, as we hear the word of Christ preaching to us every day. Christ continues to feed us on a daily manner. Maybe not the food out of our refrigerator, but food that we can live on daily with guidance and with help. Food that will nourish us the rest of our lives, just as he fed those 5,000 people with spiritual and physical food. All we have to do is look out in the world, and we see miracles happening. They happen right before us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's stand and affirm our faith today by saying the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our hymn is, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
May we pray. Lord God Almighty, may you bless each offering plate this day as it is passed down the aisles. May it be filled with the mission of your church and the ministry of this church. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. You may be seated. Before you sit down, I want everyone to turn around, look at the camera, and wave to Wayne and Carol. They are watching the service right now. So turn around and wave. Now you may all be seated. Hey, Wayne and Carol. You are in our prayers, and they watch this service every Sunday morning. And I'm sure I will have a phone call this week from Carol saying thank you. For our prayer concerns, Chuck Westworthy, I hope I said that right, Wentworth, and family, he has less than a week to live due to cancer. Prayers are uplifted for Melita, for John Hall, for Linda Martin, for Kate Dean. Kate Dean is in Encompass. They request no visitors, no phone calls, no texts. She is in therapy basically the entire day until about 2:30, quarter of 3 in the afternoon. She is doing quite well. Her daughters are taking care of her every other day, so I think they're tired also. We need to uplift prayers also for Carla Dean. She's still dealing with breathing issues, but doing much, much better. And for Peter Evans. The Evans usually sit up in this area, and they had been visiting, and he died this past week. I did visit him last Sunday in hospice. I also want to say thank you to a member of this church. When I was having, I'm still having eye problems and everything, a member of this church gave me a card of a doctor. And when I got a referral finally on Wednesday, when the doctor's office finally called me back, it is just the same doctor that she gave me a card on. So I believe God works in very mysterious ways. And I do have a doctor's appointment on Thursday, finally, so I can see again. Any other prayer requests that I need to lift up at this time? Loftless. Okay. You want to put that on a blue card so I can, well, so I can have it for the week?
Sure.
Thank you. As we go to the Lord in prayer, let us remember our church, our families, and the precious children that will be starting back to school. Let us pray. Gracious God, above all, in all and with all, we give you abundant thanks today. You have brought us through another week, a week that we have faced with smiles, with concerns, with love, a week where some of us have visited at the hospital in hospice, in aftercare facilities, prayed for families, held their hands, and you have guided us, Lord. You have guided this church and the ministry of Jesus Christ. It's where our faith is. Yes, we can look around and see other things, but our faith is in Jesus Christ at all times. We are so blessed to know Christ as our Savior. Each step we take in life, we take it with Christ at our side. Each moment that we speak, each thing that we say, Christ is holding our hand. Lord God Almighty, we look at a world that struggles. Members of this church struggle. They struggle for unity. They struggle to be well. They struggle inside, physically and mentally, and we pray for them today, Lord. For you are a very gracious God, a gracious one that guides, a gracious one that forgives. We look again out into the world, and at times we see a nation that struggles, foreign nations that struggle as well, and we pray for them, Lord. We pray for those in, or as I might say, first and second responders, those that meet the ambulance, those that come into the hospital room, and those that are guided by our medical community. We pray, O Lord, without ceasing. We pray, O Lord, for those that we have mentioned. We pray for Peter's wife, for Wayne and Carol, for Carla, for Kate, for Linda, for Sherry, for John, for Melita, and for families of Chuck's. Lord God, you hear our prayers. We ask you, Lord, to also be with those that will be traveling, those that will be away from us for a period not only of days, but a period of several weeks. We pray safe travel, and God be with them as they travel to see families and loved ones. Pray, O Lord, this day for those that serve the community of faith outside these walls of this church. Lord God, we pray for the missionaries of the world as they are guided by you within their hearts to preach the word. We ask you, O Lord, this day to forgive us. We're sinners. And we ask for your grace this day. Hear us, O Lord, be with us and guide us. So we pray the prayer that you prayed with your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is Savior, Like a Shepherd, Lead Us. Found on page 187 of your hymn books. Let us stand, please.
Thank you.
Blessed Jesus. Blessed Jesus. You love us still in the ministry of Jesus Christ. May God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you as you leave this place to go out into the world. Amen.
Thank you.